I think it goes way back to Robin Hood and things like that, that there was a myth of the person who breaks the law when it's a stupid law to give people what they want. Once the government begins forbidding things, then somebody will come along and say, I got it. Step around the corner.
I think there are really two reasons that people obey the law. One is when they just understand from the world around them, from their parents, from the traditions of their culture, from their neighbors, that this is the rule and everybody follows it. I think for laws that have been around for a long time and seem to have the power of moral suasion behind them, this is a powerful reason that people follow the law. The second reason is that they're afraid of getting caught and getting punished. This is much more important when you have a brand new law and where people are not completely convinced that the law is inherently moral.
On January 16th, 1920, Prohibition, the 18th Amendment to the Constitution, went into effect. It was intended to stop the scourge of alcoholism that afflicted millions, devastating families and ruining lives. It had been supported by most Americans, including the crusading women who had done so much to bring it about and who had now won the right to vote. Prohibition was the answer to their sincerest prayers, offering the promise that government could make society better. And at first, there were signs that prohibition was working. Alcohol consumption went down by at least a third. Alcohol-related deaths fell. So did arrests for public drunkenness. Some California winemakers began planting plums and apricots instead of grapes. Most distillers shut down, forced to padlock their vast warehouses filled with barrels of whiskey. Anheuser-Busch and a handful of other surviving brewers turned to making soft drinks and ice cream, cheese and yeast, and non-alcoholic near beers with brand names like Hoppy and Quiz, Pivo and Bevo. Coca-Cola stock more than doubled. Most small-town Americans who had lived in regions that had long since voted to limit alcohol would find their lives unchanged. Few would ever see an illegal whiskey still or encounter a prohibition agent, and they all celebrated the death of the saloon. But other Americans defied prohibition from the first, some simply because they thought it absurd that the government had no business interfering in their lives. Still others saw that there was money to be made. Their defiance would soon be everywhere and unmistakable. From the illegal speakeasy down the block to the network of bribery and corruption that eventually stretched all the way from the cop on the beat to the corridors of power in Washington. From the homebrew that families began to sell to their neighbors, to the bloody gang wars over liquor distribution that increasingly filled the morning newspapers. Many seemingly law-abiding citizens, including an up-and-coming young police officer from Seattle and a celebrated defense attorney from Chicago, would exploit the inherent inconsistencies in the law and transform themselves into some of the country's most successful criminals. A 32-year-old federal official, a pioneer defender of the rights of women, would zealously prosecute those violators, even as her own superiors were routinely flouting the law. In its eagerness to show that the new rules really could be enforced, the government did not shrink from bending and sometimes even breaking long-established laws, threatening rights and freedoms embedded elsewhere in the Constitution. In 1924, 4 years after Prohibition was first imposed, the Boston Herald would offer $200 to the reader who came up with a brand new word for someone who flagrantly ignored the edict and drank liquor that had been illegally made or illegally sold. 25,000 responded. Two readers split the prize. Each had come up with the same word, scofflaw.